You saw it appearing with the half Laplacian in Enrico's thoughts, but now we are doing the local case, which is with the Laplacian. And it doesn't matter so much which nonlinearity you have here, but a nonlinearity of this type that we call bistable. Bistable, because it's negative here, positive here, it has two zeros, in this case, minus one and one. And the associated potential is like that. We call it a double well potential with two wells at the same height. One and minus one have the same energy, let's say zero. Okay, so I will call F the nonlinearity, and I will call W, say, the potential. And this is a model. This is a model for phase transitions. In the case of the half Laplacian, it appeared in this location of crystals, right? Here I would say that it appears in reaction problems, so in reaction in chemistry or in biology also. And the idea is you should think of U as a density. Of a population, or think that there are two populations, say, mixed together. And U equals one means that at that point of space there is only population A. And U equals minus one means that at that point of space there is only population B. U equals zero means that at a point X equals zero means that at that point there is 50-50 of both populations, okay? So it's a density, okay? And the Laplace models the diffusion, which means that populations want to move around randomly with Brownian motion to look for food, say, okay, for instance. They diffuse. And this is the reaction term, and you better think it in the energy level here with this double well potential. It's telling you, which tells us, if you want to minimize this, then you want to be at one or minus one, which means only the total separation of the two populations. Okay, U equals one means that at this point, at this part of space, there is only population A. And if they mix, because they move randomly, they will mix. If they mix, and for instance, at a point of space that is 50-50, then the potential energy is very big. So there is something going against you, you don't like. you don't like to be around, surrounded by people of the other species, okay? So what you like is to be with the guys of your species, okay? So this is the way you should understand this. And then there is a connection of this equation, very beautiful connection, with minimal surfaces, okay? With minimal surfaces, which means that you put a parameter here, epsilon squared, very small, epsilon will go to zero, and you look at this in a domain, say for instance in a bounded domain of Rn, and you have certain boundary conditions or certain constraint of volume of total density, total mass of the populations or something like this. This doesn't matter. The important thing is that as epsilon goes to zero, you see you will have an epsilon square here. The separation, the mechanism that separates the guys is stronger and stronger as epsilon goes to zero. So it really forces the guys to really want to separate. What happens as epsilon tends to zero is that, in fact, it would be, for instance, in dimension three, in fact, they will separate. As epsilon goes to zero, they will separate. The limiting configuration, let's call it U0, for instance, of a minimizer, will be that in a certain region of the domain, U0 will be minus one, in the other one will be plus one, and then you want to understand what are these regions and what is the interface that separates them, okay? The interface that separates the guys. It will be this surface. And there is a beautiful theorem of modica mortola that says the guys don't like each other, they will separate, and they will separate in such a smart way that the interface that separates them will have the smallest area possible to touch the least possible the other, to be in contact the less possible with the other species. So in the limit, the boundary, say, of where u0 is less than 1, which is this surface, is a minimal surface. And this is the theorem, variational theorem of modica mortola, that uses a very nice concept developed mainly by De Giorgi, which is called gamma convergence. And this gives sense to all this limiting process. And you can learn it in many places. But for instance, you can read in a paper that I will mention later on by Giovanni Alberti, Luigi Ambrosio, and myself, 2001. Okay, it's the only one we have together. You will find all this in my webpage, the links. Okay, so this is the motivation of Allen Kahn and the connection with minimal surfaces that we already understand quite well. Okay, so let's go ahead, otherwise we won't have time. So just from this and the shape of the nonlinearity, which is, you see, it's negative here, it's positive here, you can prove with the maximum principle easily that the absolute value of u has to be less or equal than 1. Okay? And in fact, it has to be either, and then you also use the strong maximum principle, it has to be either strictly less than 1, or u is less than. U is identically 1, or u is identically minus 1. Which, these are trivial minimizers, because they don't pay Dirichlet energy, they don't pay potential energy, they have the possible. So these are minimizers, but are trivial, say, minimizers. So from now on, adding the hypothesis that I'm going to assume the equation, and I'm going to assume that u is strictly less than 1, okay? So it's a density. Huh? It's a density. U equals 2, it makes no sense. Huh? It's between minus 1 and 1. So minimality, you know what it means. Always compact domain. So energy, minimizer, energy, say in a ball of radius r of u is less or equal than the energy in the ball of every function such that agrees with u on the boundary. So this is the definition for minimizer, as always. U minimizer, and then U stable, definition also, U stable means that the second variation of energy, say in every ball, for instance, at U is greater or equal than 0, which means this is a quadratic form. And this means if you make it, you see, if you make it, it means that it means this inequality, f prime of u psi squared greater or less or equal than grad psi squared for every psi, say, C1 with compact support in a rank, for instance. That's enough. And then since it has compact support, if you want, you integrate in a rank. Or you integrate in bounded domains, it's the same. This is the same as f by density, f prime of u, psi squared less or equal in a ball of radius r, grad psi squared, and for every psi in H1, say in H1 0, that vanishes on the boundary of the ball. And this is also equivalent to the linearized operator being non-negative definite in every ball with Dirichlet, whatever we are, with Dirichlet boundary conditions. Dirichlet. Or if you want, that the first Dirichlet eigenvalue of this operator, Schrodinger operator, in every ball is greater or equal than 0. All this is the same. and I'm pretty sure that you already are familiar with this. Not just review the things, but it's all the same, okay? So every minimizer is stable, but stable is a larger, in principle could be a larger class, okay? And if you see, I'm working with solutions, could work with solutions in bounded domains. I'm working with solutions in all space. Eh? We call them sometimes entire solutions, okay? So the first thing that you look is that the simplest possible solutions, besides the trivial ones, the simplest solutions are solutions that depend only on one Euclidean variable, okay, 1D solutions. Do they exist? Yes. They are solutions of the form U star of X scalar product with E. E is a vector, unit vector. And who is U star? Well, it's explicit. U star, and this is an exercise for you, very simple. It's the hyperbolic tangent of Y over square root of 2. It's a function. So this is the transition, the solution, the 1D transition, U star, this is Y, and it goes like this. It goes to 1 and minus 1, and this goes here exponentially because it's the hyperbolic tangent. So check that minus U star double prime is U star minus U star cube. It's just an exercise, very simple computation, and note that it's an increasing solution. The derivative is positive in R, okay? It's an increasing solution. So, okay, these are very simple solutions, okay? So these are the solutions like this. It's a function of one variable, and I put it in Rn like this, or like that, like that, like that, okay? It's the simplest possible solution. A more general class of solutions are the ones that satisfy this. And they will be of interest, you will see. The Georgis thought about these solutions for first time. So we also look at monotone solutions with limits. We call them like this, which is, this will be, by definition, I will say a monotone solution with limits. It's a solution of the equation in Rn, always of absolute value less than 1. And in one direction, now it depends on the n variables, okay? But in the last direction, say, for instance, this is to choose one direction, but you could choose another one, doesn't matter. In the last direction, say, xn, but you could change, you could consider another direction, is positive, the derivative is positive, so it's monotone in the xn direction, and not only it's monotone, we will assume that as xn goes to plus minus infinity, like here, the solution goes to plus minus 1, and this for every x prime in Rn minus 1. So here you denote points by x prime xn, okay? And this limit is not necessarily, I don't assume that it is uniform in x prime. Not necessarily uniformly in x prime. Otherwise, it's too restricted. It's too small class. This class is more interesting. Okay, so theorem. That's already when I started working at this, well, all this comes from a conjecture of De Giorgi from 1979 that I will mention now in a second. And that, surprisingly, was open for many years, 79, and I started working at this in 99, 20 years, there was almost no progress, okay, in 20 years. And in the beginning, really, we didn't understand. But I'll tell you now, you will see it right away, we will prove it in 1 minute after these classes. And we didn't know even this, which is a little, we still didn't know even this theorem here that you will see now so simple. We means we all, okay? Including the guys from Pisa, the guys from Austin, the guys from everywhere, okay? So at the end, at the end, we found out with Giovanni Alberti, it was a lot of help in Pisa. Myself and Luigi Ambrosio, also in Pisa, 2001. And this is a paper, you will find it in my webpage. And it says, every solution like this, because the conjecture of De Giorgi spoke about solutions of this type, at least of this type. Every solution like that, in particular, the 1D solutions, are minimizers. Okay? So this is the equivalent, say, of several theorems that we have seen. The minimal, the Simons cone is a minimizer in dimension 8. That harmonic map, so simple to write x over mod x, is a minimizer in dimension 7 and higher. Here, every dimension, for every n, for every solution u satisfying, sorry, I have in my notes 9 and 10, so let me write 9 and 10, you can adapt to your notes. For every solution u satisfying 9 and 10, u, and for every dimension, u is a minimizer. Okay, proof. We have to build a calibration. And this is what we didn't know how to do. But it's in front of you, almost. We have this solution. So this is the xn direction. We have this solution. It's not a function of one variable. It's a function of all variables. But it's monotone on the xn direction, and it goes to 1 and minus 1. So these are the levels, minus 1, 1. So you have this solution, I don't know what it does, but it will go from 1 to minus 1. I'm fixing here, in this picture, I'm fixing 1x prime, right? I can, but you should think that there are all the x primes are here, right? And we have many blackboards. But at every blackboard, the profile is maybe different, okay? Maybe different. Very good. But it's always monotone and goes from 1 to minus 1. So imagine all these profiles, but they are different. This one here is different, but it goes from minus 1 to 1. And then what we are going, the calibration is going to be...
That's x prime and r to the n minus 1, right?
Sorry?
R to the n minus 1, the x prime.
R to n minus 1, thanks. So now we are going to slide u. This is the key word. Slide u. So for every t in r, we are going to consider ut of x equals u of x prime, and then xn plus t. Slide to the right and to the left. For instance, to the right. So now, thanks to the monotonicity, if t is positive, I guess ut is larger than ut is larger, right? Yes. And if t is negative, ut is smaller than u, and this in the whole space. So for t positive, you have this. Well, sorry, it's the same profile. It's the same profile, but like this, here, and here. And for t negative, you have these guys, same profile, but just like that. So it's quite simple, and they are all solutions. And they produce a foliation. If you have a foliation, you are top. Remember this. I told you foliation is the most expensive thing that you can dream for, okay? Even more than a calibration. It will give a calibration, but if you have the foliation, you can do even simpler arguments. foliation of Rn cross minus 1, 1. Because all this is going to fill Rn cross minus 1, 1 because of the limits. You see? Because of the limits. So now, how do you make the proof? Okay. Take a ball or a domain, whatever, any domain or a ball. It's enough because balls fill up everything. And consider the game. The competition game means who has less. So the ball, when I go here, it will be something like that, okay? So it will be a compact domain with all the other blackboards. So the game finishes here. With the boundary values of U, because this is U and these are the UT, who has the less possible energy? Well, it's very simple in this case to prove that there exists a minimizer, an absolute minimizer, because the problem is so simple, it's so coercive. Look, everything is positive. This term is bounded because everything is between 1 and minus 1. So very simple calculus of variations, no problem at all. There exists a minimizer. There exists the minimizer of the energy in the ball of radius r among functions which agree on the boundary with u. Very good. It exists. And it's going to be between minus 1 and 1 by the maximum principle. I draw it here, and maybe it goes up, maybe it goes down below u, but it's something like that. And now you see the proof. This guy is between minus 1 and 1, so for t very negative, you are below it. So ut goes to minus 1 as t goes to minus infinity. So ut is strictly less than v in the full ball close this compact set if t is negative enough, if t is very negative. And now you consider t star the supremum of the t's such that this happens, okay? Which means that you are looking at these green leaves, for instance, well, t negative are these leaves, the green ones. This one is below the red. This one is also below. There is a first one that has to touch. And now be careful. It could touch on the boundary. It could touch on the boundary. That would be very, very bad. But it cannot because by monotonicity, okay? All these green are below. So it has to touch at an interior point, and that's a contradiction because then you have two solutions of the same semilinear equation, one below the other, so then there is a T star, and then you have minus Laplacian U minus U cube, minus Laplacian U star, UT star equals the same UT star minus UT star cube. And you know that U, T star, is smaller or equal than U in the whole ball.
It's V, right?
Sorry?
It's V.
It's V. U star touches the minimizer, which is V. Thank you. And at a point, with equality at an interior point. And now this is an easy exercise. Let me write it here. Just consider the difference, W, the difference, V minus U, T star. And you will see that V satisfies an equation of this type. Schrodinger linear equation, and capital V is some guy that depends on V and U T star. It's some guy, but it's a bounded nice potential, and you have W, what do you have? W what? Greater or equal than zero, and zero at an interior point contradiction by the strong maximum principle. Okay. Well, it they have to agree. They have to agree, and that's a contradiction because on the boundary they don't agree. The red guy is larger than the green guy. Okay, so contradiction. So it's the same argument that we did with the Simon's code with the foliation. Okay, and this proves even more. That's what you said the other day. This proves that in a presence of foliation, the Dirichlet problem has always a unique solution. Wrong what I said. In the presence of a foliation, the Dirichlet problem with the boundary values given by one of the leaves has a unique solution. So if you give me another boundary problem, which is this Dirichlet boundary value here, but this one on this side, I don't know if there is uniqueness or not. Probably there is no uniqueness, okay? So, but with the values of every function in the foliation, there is uniqueness. And that's what we proved here, okay? So the red guy has to be the white guy is the red, but the red was the minimizer, the white guy is a minimizer, okay? So this is the end of the proof. Okay, let's go there. Okay. So this in the beginning we were so still so bad. Maybe we would have talked more with people in minimal surfaces, we would have made progress faster but we didn't. Because people in minimal surfaces are more used to this foliation argument than all this. So in fact, here you really don't see the foliation so much. The calibration. Yes.
Sorry, maybe I don't understand, but it looks to me that you prove not there exists, there doesn't exist a V minimizer, but there's nothing with lower energy is what you just proved here. So the V, we assume there's some V.
No, we assume no. The calculus of variations tells you that there exists an absolute minimizer.
That guy has less
possible energy in this ball
with
these boundary values.
Okay, I was just reading it wrong.
And now you prove that this guy with the possible, the least possible energy is you.
Mm-hmm.
So you are done, okay?
Got it.
Okay. So here you see the foliation, but you don't see the calibration. So if you want to see, but the proof is longer to see the calibration, which means a vector field. It's a vector field like it's a vector field that in minimal surface, if you remember, it was something like that for that function x prime 4 minus y prime 4. Is in minimum surfaces. Here there is also a vector field defined in Rn cross minus 1, 1 with properties 1, 2, and 3. 1, 2, and 3. What is this x? This x is this. Look, it's this vector field. It's this vector field, in fact, if I remember well, it should be this one. Yes, the tangent, this is x. And it satisfies certain properties. And then, without using the existence of minimizer, but which is a trivial thing, you can prove the minimality just using the calibration. But it is longer, okay? It is longer. And this implies minimality. And I'm saying that this is a longer proof, but it's the first one that we were able to carry. And this you will find it in the paper by Alberti, Ambrosio, and myself, okay? If you want to read that. This is simpler. I was presenting this one day, and one day Luis Caffarelli came and said, okay, why don't you do it like this? And I said, okay, that's faster. That's faster. very good. So that's the theorem. Corollary, the Guandi solutions are minimizers, which is not a trivial thing. Well, it's not so clear. Corollary 6, any 1D solution, or every 1D solution, is a minimizer. Okay, that's good. And this for every dimension, huh? For every dimension. Very good. Next. A very important theorem by Ovidius Sabine, paper It's His Thesis, Annals of Math. He did this when I was in Austin, 2002-2003, but the Annals of Math are very picky, and they had to check 6 years, right? It will say maybe not 6 years, but at the end it appeared in 2009, but the paper is beautiful. It says that if you have a solution of the Allen-Kahn equation and U is a minimizer, as you assume that U is a minimizer, and you assume that the dimension of space is less or equal than 7, then U is a 1D solution.
Is the problem with the Annals of Math is that they're not picky enough, so they have an enormous backlog because they accept too much material.
Oh yes, but not if it needs.
I'm sure it didn't take 6 years to get refereed, I'm sure it was.
Okay, they accept a lot, but not in PDEs, maybe in harmonic analysis or something like that, okay? I'm joking, but not so joking, okay? So you see, this is like the Simon's theorem. In small dimensions, the only minimizers are 1D solutions. And the theorem is beautiful because it has no extra assumption, nothing. A minimizer is 1D up to dimension 7. So if n is less or equal than 7, the only minimizers, minimal surfaces, are hyperplanes. For minimal surfaces are hyperplanes. And for this, the only minimizers let me write it in two different ways, are 1D solutions. But what are the 1D solutions? Are solutions that have all level sets equal to hyperplanes. A 1D solution, right, is a solution that all its level sets are parallel hyperplanes, okay? And hyperplanes are the minimal surfaces which are minimizing in these dimensions. So the proof of Ovidiu is difficult. I mean, it's deep. It's deep proof. We are not going to discuss this. It uses something that he invented or conceived, which is an improvement of flatness. There were some results about this of this type for minimal surfaces, and then he does it for the Allen-Kahn equation, and then he uses also the result of minimal surfaces. He uses Simon theorem on minimal surfaces that we proved, that we talked about these days.
Yes.
The classification of cones or of the classification of cones, and therefore the classification of entire minimal surfaces. But yeah, the classification of cones. So the argument, the modicum ortho argument that I told you that it's quite rough because it's a variational argument that tells you in the limit the interface should be a minimal surface. This is very rough said like that because it's a gamma convergent theorem. But he does it much more precise and sees that that at the end he gets a minimal cone, that then he knows using this that it has to be flat, and from that you have to deduce then that not only the limit is flat, but all the level sets are flat. So you use that they are close to something which is flat. This is the using the classification of cones, some limiting object is flat. And your level sets converge to this. So in a way, they have to be quite flat. And then you use this part to prove this flat and prove that they are really flat, okay? So that's a very important theorem, but we are not going to discuss more the proof because it would take us more than a week, say. Oh, I forgot a corollary. I wanted to write corollary.
So can I ask a question?
Sure.
So in that theorem, is there no assumption of that kind that the UX,
no.
The derivative in some direction is positive? And
no assumption.
Negative one and one.
No assumption in that theorem. But you see, it applies to these solutions because if you have a solution like this, we know now that it's a minimizer, and therefore, if you're up to dimension 7, it will be 1D. Okay? So let's write this as a remark. Okay, so the red guy is too strong. So, yeah, remark. Any solution satisfying 9 plus 10 in Rn with n less or equal than 7 is a 1D solution.
Are there examples of non-1D solutions?
Now we arrive to that.
Yeah.
But this, I wanted this to be theorem 8 because I wanted to put another corollary. Corollary 7, sorry about that. That is from corollary of what? Of theorem 5. Huh? Every solution satisfying 9 and 10. Or more generally, every minimizer, it's a larger class, minimizers, solutions satisfying 9 plus 10 are always minimizers. Or more generally, every minimizer satisfies the optimal, let me write this, because I want you to know that this you cannot do better, the optimal energy bound like this. There exists a constant C independent of R such that the energy of the solution in a ball of radius R is less than C times Rn minus 1. And before the proof, remark, this is trivial for 1D solutions. Exercise. If you have a 1D solution, take a ball of radius R, or a cube. It's simpler because I'm going to do Fubini. Take a cube. Integrate the energy, grad u square, all that stuff, in this cube. The function only depends on this variable. So I do Fubini. And this integral of one variable, I have to repeat it on the other n minus 1 variables. So I get Rn minus 1 here. And what do I get here? Well, you can check that the integral from minus infinity to plus infinity of 1 half u star prime square plus 1 4 1 minus u star square is finite. So this 1D solution of the ODE has finite energy in the whole line, okay? So if you integrate it in a ball of reusar, it gives you 3. And then you have the n minus 1 other, the other n minus 1. Okay? So proof. How do you prove this energy estimate, which is crucial? I mean, it's very important. You cannot do anything if you don't have this energy. You, Sabine could do nothing if you don't have this energy, okay? Energy estimate. How do you prove this? Say for a solution, a monotone solution, 9 and 10. Well, you know that it's a minimizer. And now from the fact that it's a minimizer, it is trivial. We will see now, it is very simple, it's trivial to deduce the energy estimate. And this goes like that. You take a ball of radius, you take a ball of the ball of radius r, and now you take a ball of radius r minus 1. And you consider a competitor, which is a function v, or w, let's call it w, which is identically u in vr minus 1. And then you use a cutoff. That's very simple to write. I let you write it, all this exercise. You cut it off so that w is equals to, no, sorry. In the ball of radius r minus 1, it's going to be 1. And on the boundary of vr, it's going to be u. So it's like that. Let me make a 1D picture. This is 0, this is r minus r, and here there is u. I don't know what that, what is u. For instance, u is this, u is this, u is this, and now you change. You look at this competitor, a competitor that in ri minus 1 minus r plus 1 is identically 1. Identically 1. Because 1 has no energy. I mean, it pays no energy. And then here, with the cutoff, make it equals u here. And make it equals u. Well, you pay something here, but not too much because everything is bounded. And you have a room of one unity. You have a room of one unity, and the heights are at most 2. So that's OK with a cutoff. And what do you deduce? You deduce that, well, it's a competitor. U is a minimizer. U has less energy than everybody. So U has less energy than W. Did I call it W? Yeah. U has less energy than W. So U is a minimizer, so the energy of U is less or equal than the energy of W. But you see, in the energy of W, W pays nothing on the ball of radius r minus 1, because it's constant and it has zero potential energy. So all the energy of W is here. But you can check small w, capital W. You can check that all this is bounded because of that reason that I had one unity of space to go from 2 to minus 2 at most, and all this. So it's bounded. So this is bounded by the measure of this annulus. But if you compute the measure of this annulus, it's Rn minus 1. It's not Rn. It's Rn minus 1. That is the proof. Okay. And now one more remark. With this energy estimate.
Sorry, this shows you control as R goes to infinity, and there's no problem that R goes to 0.
Sorry?
Sorry, this
should, oh, this is for R large.
Yeah.
This for R large, sorry. I should have written here. This is for R large, R greater than 1. I only care about big balls, OK? Yeah.
You should also have a monotonicity formula that can tell you.
There is a monotonicity formula This will be next remark. Thanks.
There's one more here.
Let me come. Yes?
Small balls even R to the N.
For small balls, you cannot do better than R to the N. Yes. But I don't care. We don't care about small balls here. Here, we have to get the limiting minimal surface going to infinity. Okay, going to infinity. R, sending R to infinity. So small balls here are not important at all. With this energy estimate, there is a simple proof of theorem 8 of rigidity. Theorem 8 in dimensions 2 and 3. If n is equals 2 and 3, and this was done before Sabine theorem. This was done by Gossoup and Gui, and I will tell you where the ideas stem from later or tomorrow. And in dimension 3, and you can look at this proof in my paper, this was my result with Ambrosio. Ambrosio, Cabre, 2000. So we prove it in dimension 3, and our main difficulty was to have the energy estimate. But now we know more things, and the energy estimate, thanks to the foliation, and this simple argument is very simple. So if you go to this paper, you can skip all the parts, skip proof of energy estimate, which is another proof that I was very happy to find. But now there is a simpler way to find. So skip the proof of energy estimate and just go directly how to get the rigidity result from the energy estimate. But the method is very simple, quite simple, but only applies in dimension 2 and 3. Okay? It cannot apply in dimension 4 or 5 or 6 or 7. And Sabine's result is much more sophisticated, and it uses the classification of minimal combs. Okay?
Yeah. Is this the log cutoff trick?
Huh?
Is this the log cutoff trick?
This is the Liouville theorem. Yeah. The Liouville theorem with the cutoff, yeah, the Liouville theorem. That only works in low dimensions. I will say a word about it, but later on, okay?
Is there some example?
Now we go to counterexample. Just, but that's good that you go fast, but I cannot go so fast. Somebody said, you said monotonicity formula. Yeah, these are two very important results. The first results on entire solutions of Allen Kahn were made by a great Italian mathematician, Modica, the one of Modica Mortola, Luciano Modica. There are several Modica. So it applies also to other nonlinearities, every nonlinearity, in fact, pretty much. And these are very nice CPAM papers. Luciano Modica, before all this stuff. So when the Georgi conjecture is in 79, and then Modica started with it, or maybe Modica already had talked to the Georgi, and blah, 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 blah. So these papers are from the 80s, beginning of the 80s. And there are two results, as you said. First, the first one, a monotonicity formula for the energy. How does the energy depend on R? Well, this quantity, the energy divided by R to the N minus 1, is monotone increasing in R. So it simply says that this is monotone increasing in R for if you have an entire solution. And then you use the monotonicity formula and the maximum principle he used to prove a Modica, something that is called the Modica estimate, which is very nice, and it says in this, for the Allen Kahn equation, it says that if you have a solution, entire solution, entire means in the whole space, like in all of these things, the potential the Dirichlet density is smaller than the potential density. Everywhere, point wise. These are two results that are very important, and that I guess Sabine also uses. Yeah, Sabine also uses in the proof. Okay. So now, up to dimension 7, there are no interesting solutions besides 1D solutions. So what happens in higher dimensions? So theorem 8.
We're at 9
because we had 9. So here there is a mistake. Okay, 9. Why there is a mistake here? Okay, there's a mistake. Theorem 9, and this is also an Annals of Math paper. Very nice one. I never know how to write the name of this guy. Delpino, Kowalczyk, and Jungchen Wei, 2011. He proved that in dimension 9, there is a non-trivial minimizer. So in dimension 9, there exists a solution satisfying 9 and 10. So monotone with limits 1 and minus 1, in particular, it's a minimizer. It is built through a method which is pretty much the implicit function theorem. It's called the gluing method. Implicit function theorem, gluing method that was known for minimal surface. You have a minimal surface here. You have a minimal surface there. Can you glue them together and being a minimal surface? You do it with implicit function theorem and quite careful analysis and quite, it's not easy. The paper is long. And they adapted this not for minimal surfaces, but for semilinear equations, okay? And it has given many results. In particular, maybe the most important one is this one. Okay.
So the claim is there is a solution of 9 and 10 which is not 1D, or what's
the name? There exists a solution satisfying 9 and 10 which is not 1D. In particular, it is a minimizer not depending only on one variable. Thank you. So you see the open problem, right? Dimension 8. Yes.
Good things that come with from this.
I'll make another talk anyway this afternoon after what was the time? Because you're asking so much that I need one more hour. So today at 5:30, one more hour. No, I'm joking. Tell me.
Whenever you wanted to show that something is a minimizer, you needed to construct some sort of foliation. So how would you do that with something that is so implicit?
Okay, here, I was going to tell you a word, but there are so many things. How do I build this? A gluing theorem. Okay, gluing theorem method, using a minimal surface also. Not a minimal surface, but a minimal graph. What do we have here? Okay, nothing, good. So, you know that in dimension 8, the Simon's cone is a minimizer of minimal surfaces. It's a minimal cone in dimension 8. So let's make a picture. In dimension 8, the Simon's cone, it's a minimizer of area. From this, Bombieri, De Giorgi, and Giusti, who were the first one to prove that this guy was a minimizer, but much more difficult than what we are doing here. So you are very lucky guys, okay? From this, they built a minimal graph in dimension 9. So x9, now we are in R9. They build a solution which is a graph. You see, the cone is not a graph in R8. It's not a graph because it crosses here. You cannot put it as a graph. But then from this, they build a solution that vanishes here, and then starts positive like that, starts positive on this side of the cone, and it grows, in fact, as a power, it goes to plus infinity as a power, x to the whatever distance to the origin to the power, I don't remember. 3? You think 3? Okay, very good. It's symmetric, you have the same thing here. And then it's also anti-symmetric. You have the same thing here, but negative, okay? But negative, right? So it goes down here it goes down, okay? It goes down. It goes down like that.
So the
function
is the zero set.
And zero, and here it's negative, here it's positive, and this function is the zero set. And this is a minimal graph, and in particular, it's a minimizer, minimizing all the graphs. If they have zero mean curvature, they are minimizing. That's another theorem, but we could prove it, but we don't have time, okay? And there it goes negative there, okay? Now, they use this to try to find a solution of Allen-Kahn, which is approximately zero on this graph. On this graph is pretty much, this graph is more or less the zero level set. And then U increases on this direction and decreases on the other and satisfies this in our line. So what they build is a solution which is increasing and goes plus one and goes to minus one here. And they build it thanks to the existence of this minimal graph built by Bombieri de Giorgi Giusti. And then you apply theorem theorem five. You apply theorem five, and you know that it is a minimizer. So it's the first counterexample, okay, minimizer. And it is not 1D. It is not 1D because its zero level set is not a hyperplane. It's almost this minimal graph, okay? Very far from being flat. Okay, so this is how it goes. Oh, we have to finish, but okay, let me just state the open problem, right? Well, I can do this also tomorrow, but you see, open problem. And we will speak a little more about this. What happens with dimension 8? And this is totally open. Well, totally. I tell you what is known tomorrow. Is there a minimizer which is not 1D? And I guess it is. It exists. And I will tell you how it looks. And I know that it's a unique guy. I will tell you this tomorrow. But still open. Okay. So this is tomorrow.
You said you know it exists, but it's still open. So
I know that exists a solution. We will see tomorrow that there exists a solution of Allen-Kahn in R8 that vanishes. So it's a solution like this. We will see tomorrow. Again, now I'm not in R8. Huh? These are different pictures. Now I'm with the set. This was a minimal surface, minimal graph. Now I go back to Allen-Kahn. Here you have the Simon's cone. And tomorrow we will see that there is a solution of Allen-Kahn in R8, which is positive here, negative here, and that's it. So it looks like that. Here it goes to 1. Here the same, and on this side, becomes negative. Okay. And this solution has a zero level set, the Simons cone. And in a paper of myself, I will tell you this tomorrow, we will prove that there exists a unique solution. This is the nice thing, unique, U satisfying these two properties to three dimensions. That is a solution and that vanishes on the Simons cone, and it's positive on this side, negative on the other side. But I don't know if it's a minimizer or not. I know some things about its stability, but this I will tell you tomorrow. Yes. So I would need one more class. So thanks for your attention.